I'm Heidi Helicobacter. I'm down here in my human host, college freshman Kristen's stomach as a member of her microbiome. What's a microbiome, you ask? Well, it is all the trillions of microbial organisms that live in and on Kristen, and any other human for that matter. I am a member of the bacteria domain, and I live in the stomach with a lot of my bacterial friends and family. Some live close by in the intestines, and others live as far away as Kristen's mouth, respiratory system, skin, and reproductive system. Scientists have been studying the microbiome, and they have discovered a lot about bacteria like me who comprise it. More recently, scientists have realized that it is not just bacteria that live here. It is also archaea, fungi, and protists. There are even quite a few viruses that inhabit the healthy microbiome. Unseen by most, we make up quite an exotic group. There are so many of us living here, at least as many of us as there are Kristen's own cells, if not more of us. Let me introduce you to some of the microbes who live here. This is my friend Millie Methanosfera, a member of the Archaea domain.
Hi, I'm Millie Methanosfera, and I'm an Archaea. Like the bacteria, my domain has been around for over 3 billion years, and we are both prokaryotic. That means our DNA is free in our cells. No need to have it enclosed in a membrane like those eukaryotes do. We are very independent, always made up of just one cell, and we are simple folk. We don't have any of those specialized organelles that eukaryotes have. I, like many archaea, am an extremophile. Extremophiles live in some pretty radical environments, such as very high or low temperatures, or where there is a lot of sulfur or salt. Here in Kristen's gut, I live where there is almost no oxygen. It is important to note that I may look similar to most bacteria, but inside I am significantly different.
Thank you, Millie. And here are a few of my other friends, Charles Chylomastix and Carla Candida.
Hi, I'm Charles, and next to me is Carla. It's nice to meet you. We're happy to finally be noticed and talked about. Everyone is so focused on the bacteria, and they forget all about us. We are eukaryotic, which means our DNA is in a special place in our cells called the nucleus. We also have a bunch of other specialized organelles that those prokaryotes just don't have. I am a protist, and Carla is a fungus. Although we are both single-celled, many eukaryotic organisms are multicellular. Our host Kristen is a eukaryote, as are all humans. Recently, scientists have started paying more attention to our role in the human microbiome.
Lastly, I want you to meet Fatima Phage, who is very different from the other organisms we've already met.
Hi, I'm happy to be included in this menagerie, even though I'm really not even considered a cell, and I'm so much smaller than the rest of you. I'm a bacteriophage, which is a type of virus. Because I can only reproduce inside a living cell, some scientists argue that I am not even really alive. Although the role of viruses as part of the microbiome is still unclear, scientists have realized that there are so many viruses found in a healthy human microbiome that we get our own name. Together, I and all my virus buddies are called the virome.
We are definitely a diverse bunch. It took a while for scientists to realize exactly how diverse, because so many microbes don't grow well in the lab, so it has been difficult to determine just how many different types of us there are. Now that there are new genetic techniques, scientists can characterize us based on our DNA.
Hey, Heidi, you forgot to introduce me. I am a bacterium also, and I want to talk about myself.
No, sorry, Carmen. You are a pathogen, and if there are too many of you, people can get very sick. That's one of the things the rest of us do down here. We take up space and resources so organisms like you can't gain a foothold.
We'll see, Heidi. We'll see. Ha 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 ha.
Sorry about that distraction. Now that I have spent so much time introducing you to my friends, let me tell you a little more about myself. My particular species, Helicobacter pylori, has been a resident in the human stomach for thousands of years. We burrow right through the mucus layer to find a nice place to live, and there is a lot for us to eat. We don't mind all the acid that is around us, and we even secrete enzymes to neutralize some of that acid and make it a little more comfortable for ourselves. In 1982, two Australian scientists, Robin Warren and Barry Marshall, determined that it isn't stress and spicy foods that cause stomach ulcers, but Helicobacter pylori. Some people react badly to us and develop sores in the lining of their stomachs. Even worse, we can be associated with stomach cancer. After this discovery, people with ulcers started taking antibiotics to get rid of us, and I had a lot fewer cousins, aunts, uncles, and other family members around. Worldwide, we live in 70% of the population, but only 30% of the people in the United States. Less than 6% of children in the U.S. test positive for H. pylori, and the incidence of ulcers has declined significantly. Sounds great, doesn't it? At least from the human perspective. Of course, things are not always how they first appear, and all I can say is our relationship with humans is complicated. Once our world of the microbiome was discovered, and scientists started analyzing exactly what roles each of us played, they realized something interesting. My family may not be so bad after all. Most people who do have us in their gut don't end up getting sick, and those who don't have us may wish they did. Loss of our species from the microbial ecosystem has been correlated with an increase in gastroesophageal reflux disease, a chronic disease that happens when stomach acid backs up into your esophagus. This is heartburn that just won't go away, and people who have this are often nauseous and may vomit frequently. Loss of H. pylori is also correlated with an increase in the incidence of esophageal cancer. When we're not around to tamp down on all that acid, bad things can happen. Even more interesting, scientists have evidence that our absence may be contributing to obesity. How in the world can the absence of a lowly bacterial species contribute to obesity? Well, it all has to do with a hormone called ghrelin. This is produced when your stomach is empty and you are hungry. Once you eat and your stomach is full, ghrelin decreases, you feel satisfied, and you stop eating. Well, apparently when Helicobacter pylori is not present, ghrelin can be produced even when the stomach is full. In that case, the brain would not receive a signal to stop eating, and someone would continue to eat even when not hungry. Over time, weight gain would occur and could progress to obesity. Like I said, our relationship with our human host is complicated. Scientists have been working hard to determine what microbial composition makes up a healthy human microbiome. Scientists no longer believe that there is an ideal set of specific microbes found in each human. One thing that does seem clear, however, is that although scientists may not understand the specific role of each microbial species in the microbiome, diversity of species is critical. There is likely a set of metabolic functions we perform, but different microbes may perform these functions in different individuals. Some of these functions include breakdown of carbohydrates, synthesis of vitamin D, regulation of pH, and education of the immune system so it functions properly. There are quite a few external factors that can change the makeup of the microbial population, such as diet, age, or antibiotic use. It is important that we be resilient and able to recover from change. If we are not able to do that, our human host can end up in dysbiosis, or in other words, a microbial imbalance.
You know, Heidi, our host Kristen takes a lot of antibiotics. Every time she gets one of those respiratory infections, her doctor prescribes them. Doesn't she realize that those drugs don't just target the bad bacteria, they target all bacteria? Talk about being at risk for dysbiosis and letting microbes like Carmen Clostridium take over.
Well, Millie, we'll just have to hope for the best. Do you know that quite a few important studies to fully characterize our role in human health and disease are ongoing? The National Institute of Health coordinates the Human Microbiome Project, and anyone can go to their website for updates on research. One day, analyzing your microbiome may be just another part of a routine physical, and manipulating it when you are ill may be one more way to restore health.